It is now truly a pleasure to introduce Dr. Ruth Potee. Ruth is not here today because she is out of state, and you could read a more extensive biography of her in your handout. Today's conversation would not be as strong without her words, her voice, and vision. Dr. Potee is that rare balance of seeing things from the 30,000-foot level, but also able to engage with her patients and their families in her office and in the trenches in this community on a daily basis. Having grown up in this community, she has returned to practice medicine, has become a leader here in the treatment of the addicted, as well as in the development of our community response to this crisis. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Ruth Potee, Gary, if you will.
I just wanted to be able to add a medical perspective to the conversation of this room. I trained actually in South Boston, and I trained at the old Boston City Hospital, Boston Medical Center, in the 1990s, and watched the opiate epidemic really hit Boston in the 1990s. And at the time, it was the beginning of the notion that pain is the fifth vital sign, and that pain should be treated at the highest level possible until pain is disappeared. What we know, and we knew then, and we certainly know now, is that's certainly not possible, and that the opiate use over time can develop into addictive behaviors for many people. So my dad was a small town doctor out here. I'm from here. He was a local doctor at a local hospital, and he never used opiate pain medicine unless somebody was dying, and that's the way it was. It was that way in the 60s and the 70s and the 80s, and it wasn't until the mid to late 90s that we began to use opiates to help treat all kinds of conditions, fibromyalgia, migraines, arthritis, low back pain. And many of us on that list I just named have those conditions. And the standard of care had become that if people walk in with pain, you give them opiates. The sense that we were all given is only 5% of people would get addicted to these drugs. And most of us think that number is totally not right. Probably the number is closer to 25% of people are actually addicted to their pain medicine. I don't mean dependent. 100% of people who are using opiates chronically are dependent on that drug. They will withdraw if not getting it. But I think the number is 20 to 25% who are actually addicted to that drug. The study that really promoted pain as the fifth vital sign was based on 39 patients. And I think at the end of the day, Big Pharma was the major big push behind this. The best studies look at fewer than 500 patients over a period of 8 months. So that is pathetic in terms of medical science. There are 10 million Americans living with chronic pain, and I'm basing all my opiate treatment on less than 500 patients. That's crazy. So more studies need to be done looking at what opiates do to people long term. At this point, long term opiate use in people in general leads to underemployment and disability. It's never clear to me why this is the case, but we're working on 3 or 4 year old Department of Public Health data. So every number you see out there is 2010 or 2011 or 2012. I guarantee you that things are much worse than they were in 2010, 2011, and 2012. At the time that I was working at the South Boston Community Health Center on West Broadway Street in South Boston, OxyContin had really hit the streets. We were prescribing it a lot. We had been told by Purdue Pharma that it was a drug that was long-acting and not abusable. It was very fast for people who wanted to get high, for them to realize that if you crushed that pill, if you snorted it, if you crushed it and swallowed it, if you crushed it and injected it, it was a fabulous high. It was a high as good as many typical heroin on the streets. So people began abusing that drug. I think we all remember the time of OxyContin being abused throughout the entire Northeast corridor. So more of us are seeing this way in the medical community. We're less comfortable with using opiates for any reason. We're tightly controlling how we dispense. We're asking people to come in and be evaluated far more frequently. We do urine drug screening to make sure that people are using the drugs we give them and not using illicit street drugs. It's one of the reasons why pills on the street have become more scarce and more expensive. It's a good thing. The unintended consequence has been that heroin is cheap and deadly. But it's a good thing that pills are less available. We're also urging our patients for whom we do prescribe pain meds to lock them up at all times. You should have a lockbox that's bolted down and that is really as tamper resistant as possible. A safe is a good idea. We ask people to keep logbooks of their pills to make sure that their kids aren't accessing them. So those are things that we used to never talk about with our patients, and now we talk about routinely. It's standard screening when a chronic pain patient comes in to make sure that only they are getting their meds and nobody else, and that they're keeping their community safe. And in fact, if a patient is not able to keep the community safe from their pain pills, their meds are getting stolen, we'll stop prescribing for them. And if opiates are dragging them down, we need to wean them off. And we discuss that with people all the time. We wean them down as low as we can go, and then we try other modalities of treatment. You know, there's lots of studies that look at Alexander technique, yoga, acupuncture, acupressure, good physical therapy, regular exercise that make people stronger and healthier again. And we need to work on that. And that stuff needs to be funded. It needs to be researched as well. The way that people usually start abusing drugs is somebody, 70% of the time, it's a family member or friend, gives them a pill. And this pattern of behavior, I see it all day long. People say to me, somebody gave me half a Klonopin. It made me feel better. Can you give me some Klonopin, doc? And I think to myself, what kind of friend or family member is handing you bottles of pills? Like, why is that okay? Do they have a medical license? Are they a pharmacist? It isn't okay to be using other people's pills. And it isn't just actually the children, the 17-year-olds and the 22-year-olds, but it's their parents and their grandparents who need to be retrained to think to themselves that, first of all, if you have a bottle of pills in your house that is a controlled substance and you're not actively using it right now, it needs to be destroyed. Today was just a normal work day for me. I saw brand new baby at the hospital who was 12 hours old, and I saw a 96-year-old patient at the hospital, and I saw hypertension and diabetes, and I saw 8 people under the age of 25 with heroin addiction. And interestingly, they all tell me the same stories, right? They started with the pills when they were 15 or 16. It didn't take long before the pills stopped working, and they realized that they could buy heroin anywhere in Franklin County at this point, much easier than they could buy alcohol. And at this point, with much greater ease than buying the pills have become very expensive and the heroin's very cheap. And the problem with this drug is that it's buyer beware, because you don't know what you're getting when you buy a bag or a bundle of dope from anybody, and the dose that you took yesterday, the same dose today, could kill you. Having said that, there's a window of opportunity here, because people are scared. A lot of people with addiction on the streets right now are very, very anxious about the quality of the heroin out there, and they don't want to die. They don't really want to have this disease at all. They actually want to be free from this disease. They don't want to be actively using heroin. They want treatment. And we live in the most rural, the poorest, the most agricultural county of the 13 counties in Massachusetts, and there's not a lot of treatment options here. That their closest intensive outpatient substance abuse program to Franklin County is down in Northampton. The window of opportunity, when somebody walks into you and says, I need help now, you've got about 3 hours before they're going to go back out and use. They're going to start withdrawing soon. They're going to start craving the drug, and they're going to be back on the street. You have a small window of opportunity to get them into treatment. And one of the problems is that we spend hours and hours on the phone, case management in every hospital, case management in every ER, desperately trying to find a bed. You can't tell me that there's not a way to develop a technology, an app on your smartphone, that can track every bed in Massachusetts and its status, whether it's available or not, whether it's impending or not. Is it a red light, a green light, or a yellow light? You can go to Google in Boston and just task somebody in a week to make an app that can track every bed that is licensed by the Department of Public Health in this state, so that they are mandated to keep us updated every 30 minutes when a bed is available. Why are we using telephones to call the Brattleboro Retreat to find out if beds are available? I think that's crazy. What would it take to open up beds at the hospital again? What would it really take? We have doctors on staff, we have nurses on staff, we have beds available. We need treatment plans. And again, I'm not a firm believer that the only way to get clean and sober is an inpatient hospitalization. I really do think we need long-term outpatient sober living. That doesn't involve a hospital. Hospitals are expensive. It's not that outpatient long-term sober living is all that cheap either, but compared to the cost of the addiction itself, it's fairly cheap treatment. You know, I have an issue with opiate treatment because the treatment's complicated. You know, people are not sober probably ever, right? They're fighting this demon on their back, and we see this with Philip Seymour Hoffman. Here's a guy who had addiction, really battled it down when he was age 22. 23 or 24 years later, he relapses, and a year after that, he's dead. People who battle opiate addiction, alcohol addiction, it is a struggle for the rest of their lives. And the notion that you could take a person and put them into a 3 to 5 to 7 day detox and then ship them out to their streets and have a sense that somehow they're better, that's crazy. I don't know how that actually helps anybody. And in my experience, I have very few people that come out of detox and are truly improved. The truth is they're out on the streets, they're jonesing for the drug, they're weaning off of methadone or whatever they were given. Detox beds cost a lot of money, and I actually think we have to think of a new way of helping people get sober. We need an intensive outpatient treatment program here in this county. We need long-term sober living here in this county. When I say this county, you know, you go 4 counties surrounding us every direction before you get to any sober living. This is a vast area without a 90-day, 180-day, or a year-long, 6 to 12-month bed available to us. So we're covering a vast territory without any detox beds or any sober living beds. This is actually a really smart community. There's tons of great mental health people here. There's tons of people who've been living sober for decades who have a lot to give back. And the peer-to-peer work that people do is critical. I think we need to activate the community and get more people involved in helping people stay sober. I'm a big believer in exercise. In sobriety, the Exercises Medicine program at the Y has done a wonderful job of taking people with addiction and getting them to work out every single day with other people who've had a history of addiction and help them lead sort of a really good, healthy lifestyle, help them actually to experience their bodies and the pain of joints and muscles again, because for so many years they felt really nothing. Drugs numb you to everything, every emotion possible, good or bad. So right now, the one place to get clean and sober in Franklin County is the Franklin County House of Corrections. So that's unacceptable, that the only place I can safely send a 22-year-old tonight is to jail. Jail is not the best place for an addict to be. Having said that, I'm actually always grateful to the courts and to the sheriff's office, because they are an extra layer of pressure that help people stay sober. My people that do really well often have jail hanging over their heads. And the probation period, the probate court, all the work that drug court has done is much heavier of a hammer than what I carry to help keep them straight and sober. One of the problems in our community is there's a sense that if you have a problem, there's a pill to fix it, whether you have pain or whether you have anxiety or whether you know, are suffering with inattention, that there must be a magic medicine to fix all problems. To be honest with you, that attitude has to change. In summary, what I need to say is that I'm an urban trained doctor from this rural area, and I could tell you the problem here is not any different than it was in the South End or in South Boston or in Quincy. It's much the same, except we have no resources. We have very few opportunities for our kids. The distances that people have to travel to get to places are enormous, and there's no public transportation that's truly accessible. So, an equivalent problem, fewer resources, greater geography, greater poverty, and it's left us with a real crisis.